Good morning. Welcome to the Lake Chapala Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. We're delighted that you're here today. My name is Deb Gang, and I will be your service leader today. Four of our members, Cat Barnett, Sharon Robinson, Susan Miller, and Robert Barnett, will offer reflections on kindness and not judging today. Thank you for coming, and we hope you'll come again soon. And so I just want to welcome you with live from Fellowship Hall. It's the LCUUF Sunday service. Our opening words this morning are a question from Steve Maraboli. How would your life be different if you stopped making negative, judgmental assumptions about people you encounter? Let today be the day you look for the good in everyone you meet and respect their journey. Our announcements were on a slideshow before the service. If you didn't see them, they'll be sent by email in the next day or so. And a few notes. Our building is now open to all participants. We will continue to offer our service on Zoom, even as we welcome all of you back to the building. We now ask people attending in-person services to be fully vaccinated and to continue to wear masks in the building to help prevent the spread of breakthrough COVID infections. And now I want to welcome our visitors. If you're visiting with us for the first time or have returned or reconnected with us after a long absence, we invite you to say your name and tell us where you're from. If you're on Zoom, use the Zoom hand feature or just raise your hand and we'll ask you to unmute. If you're in the room, just raise your hand. We'll start with the people in the room. Is there anyone visiting today? Hold on. Let me get my mask.
Take it away.
Okay.
Hello. Hi, we're John and Jennifer Joyce. We've been here in this area, 2 months now? We're from Denver area originally, among other places. We're in witness protection down here. So.
Many of us are. Welcome. Anyone else? Is anybody on Zoom today? Okay. Have we lost the...
We can hear you.
Okay, so today's chalice lighting words are by Richard Gilbert. May we be the keepers of this flame. O flaming chalice, symbol of a free faith, burn with the spread warmth and light and hope, warm hearts grown cold with indifference. Light dark places with justice, rekindle hope in despair. May we bring fuel for thy fire of love. May the oil of loving kindness flow from us to thy leaping flame. May hands of service shelter thee, that no winds of hate may extinguish thy brightness. May thy light and warmth be eternal. May we be keepers of thy flame. Please light your chalice. And our opening hymn is number 120. Our opening hymn is number 128, For All That Is Our Lives.
Make all
Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. We do this by sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives. If you have a joy or sorrow to share today, you can type it into the chat now and we'll read those aloud. First, let us voice our sorrows or concerns, whatever you or the world may be holding that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts. You're welcome to type sorrows and concerns in the chat box. We'll start with the people here and give you on Zoom a time to type. Are there any sorrows or concerns anyone would like to share?
Hi, I'm Colleen Beery. I just wanted to share, in case you hadn't heard, my mother passed on Friday. And of course, it's a great sorrow. She was a wonderful person. But I'm very joyful that she passed very peacefully in her sleep. And I was able to see her for her 89th birthday in August. And very joyful. I had a great mother and great life with her. So thank you.
I want to send out caring thoughts to President Biden. He must be going through a lot, but we all hope everything passes as it should.
Please light a candle of concern and sorrow for Frank, who continues to deteriorate at a fairly rapid rate, and for Kate as well.
Are there any concerns on Zoom today?
Yes, we have three. First, Fred and Mardell lost their longtime pet Rudy this week. And many of us had the pleasure of knowing Rudy. And Marcia sends condolences to Colleen Beery and her family. And I have one. I would like to light a candle of deep sorrow for our contractor whose son had been murdered 2 years ago. We didn't know why he left the area, but our contractor is back. He said he took the grief with him when he went to the U.S., so he might as well be here.
Now let us recall the joys. Whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others, you're welcome to type joys in the chat box. And again, we'll start with the people here. Does anyone have a joy to share?
Hi, I'm Carol. This is both a sorrow and a joy. As many of you know, we took care of Rudy for three summers, and we loved him so much, and we're sorry that he's gone, but it was a joy to have him in our lives.
Mine is also pet-related. My beloved cat went walkabout yesterday, and I don't know yet how she got out, but she was missing for a day and a night, and I thought the worst. And yesterday she waltzed up to the door, filthy with muddy paws, and acted like nothing had happened. So I'm I'm so grateful that she's back.
Deb and I have a joy. On Friday, I got a call from my son, who's in Iceland, and after a lovely evening in the Blue Lagoon, he proposed to his partner of 5 years, Marie Mercado. So we will have a wedding in our future.
Are there any joys on Zoom?
Yes. Liz Mulder shares a joy. Her joy is that today is Bill White's birthday. And Liz says, I love him. And Helen, I hate to tell you, but Liz is not alone. A lot of us love Bill.
Okay. And this candle from our care team represents those sorrows that are too raw, too difficult for us to share aloud. So many of us have had losses, partners, children, grandchildren, losses that remain present with us every day. So many of us have burdens, anger, fear, and frustration, all of those things that weigh heavy on our hearts. We will light this candle for all those unspoken sorrows. Today's reading is from an article on the website mindfulambition.net. The author is Patrick Buggy. The mind is a judging machine. Everything that we experience is filtered, categorized, and dealt with in some automatic way. Some things are judged as good, so we grasp for more and cling to what we have. Other things are judged as bad, so we hide, resist, and run away from them. And everything else? That's judged as neutral, so for the most part, we ignore it entirely. There's nothing inherently wrong with these judgments. It's the nature of the mind to judge. Sometimes these judgments are helpful. They can lead you to understand the things that bring you up, give you energy, and fill you with purpose. They can help you understand what doesn't resonate with you and leaves you feeling drained. But when left unchecked, the judging mind is taxing and controlling. It takes significant energy to evaluate every experience you encounter. There's always something to be done about wherever you are. Chase the good, flee from the bad, and ignore the neutral. When you're unaware that these judgments are influencing your behavior, you're just along for the ride. Like a marionette reacting to a puppeteer, you become trapped by your conditioned judgments and reactions. Mindfulness presents an alternative to this vicious cycle in the form of non-judgment. As Jon Kabat-Zinn reminds us, mindfulness means paying attention in a particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, and without judgment. The last part of that definition, non-judgment, means letting go of the automatic judgments that arise in your mind with every experience you have. Setting down the judging mind, even for a short while, is a refreshing weight off your shoulders. In practicing non-judgment, there's no longer anything to be done about the present moment. No grasping for more, no resisting what's there, and no ignoring of life's experience. When you stop trying to react to your experience, you can open up to it completely, resting in mindful presence.
Kindness is the ideal for behavior that I aspire to most. When I think about being a better person, my question is often, how can I be kind all the time? I think over incidents during which I believe that I have been less than kind and imagine how they could have been different. Here is something that happened while I was in downtown Ahihik a few months ago. I was looking for parking and drove up behind someone who was parked in the street. There are only two lanes, one for parking and one for driving. So the street was blocked, my trip was shut down. No one was in the car and it didn't look like a delivery. I waited a minute and then leaned on my horn. A woman on the sidewalk yelled at me, and not in a friendly way, "Chill out." I didn't appreciate that. And I told her I did not intend to chill out behind a car parked in the street. I'm afraid I wasn't yelling in a friendly way either. Oh dear. I continued to honk at intervals, and after a few minutes, someone ran out and drove the car away. I had lost maybe 5 minutes. 5 minutes. It's so easy to get wound up. Yes, I was a little late for my Spanish class, but who cares that much about 5 minutes, especially now that I am retired. It's not a job I'm going to where I might get fired, and it's not a place I'm going to where people will be waiting for me. It's just 5 minutes out of my morning. How long was I supposed to wait before alerting the person who left the car there that there was someone waiting? I can remember times when I have parked my car somewhere I shouldn't have been, you know, because I needed to go inside somewhere for just a few minutes. I have probably caused some inconvenience to someone in the past in that way. I think the most important lesson from the story is that everyone thinks their time is more important than everyone else's. But is it? Our UU principles include an idea about the worth and dignity of all persons. All persons, including the person who parked in the street downtown. Maybe next time I will give the person blocking the street 5 minutes before I start to overheat, or maybe I will forget again. But I think that giving the person 5 minutes might increase the amount of kindness in the world. And I believe that everyone is responsible for the amount of negativity they bring into the room. We should not be bundles of conditioned responses, marionettes reacting to our brain's judgment of the situation as bad. If you yell at me, I need to take a breath. And then I need to take at least a few seconds to consider my response. Being angry or yelling, I have found, is almost never needed or effective. Now, about not judging. Out of all the ideas about how to live your life well and love others, I find the ideal of not judging events and other people to be the one that is the most difficult for me to do. I'm constantly judging everything, although I know my judgments are generally not important and that they are often incorrect. My favorite Zen story is the one that starts with a farmer who has only one horse. The horse is crucial for him to make a living, and the horse runs away. When the neighbors find out that the only horse the farmer had run away, they came to see him. They said, "Your only horse has run away just before the planting season. How will you till the land? How will you sow the seeds? This is unfortunate. This is bad. This is very bad." And the farmer replied, "Maybe." A few days later, the farmer's horse returned from the woods along with two other wild horses. When the neighbors found out the news, they said, "Now you have three horses. You can till the land much better, much faster with three horses. Maybe you can buy more land and sow more crops and make more money, or you can sell the other two horses. Either way, you will be a rich man. This is good. How wonderful." And the farmer replied, "Maybe." Next morning, the farmer's son started training the wild horses so that they would help till the land. While attempting to mount one of the horses, he fell and broke his leg. Just before the sowing season, the son would not be able to help the farmer with his broken leg. The neighbors came to see, came once again and commented, "This is really unfortunate. This is very bad." The farmer replied, "Maybe." A few days later, the king's men started to visit each village in the kingdom. A war had started between their kingdom and a neighboring state. The king's men were enlisting the eldest son from each family to join, forcibly enlisting, to join the army so that they could defeat the enemy state. When they came to the farmer's home, they saw the son with a broken leg. He would not be of much use to them, so they didn't take him. He was the only eldest son in the entire village who was not forcibly taken by the king's men to fight the war. The neighbors, some of them with heavy eyes, teary eyes, came once again to the farmer and commented, "Your son breaking his leg was really fortunate. He is the only one who was not taken. This is so good." And the farmer replied calmly, "Maybe." You understand the point of the story. As human beings, we interpret all events as either good or bad. We do this with other people as well. The way we see it, their actions are good or bad. We do this unconsciously. When we interpret events as good, we are usually happy, and vice versa. However, the most events are beyond our control. They are just events. There is nothing we can do about events beyond our control except accept them and move on. Adding our interpretation and emotional drama is usually unnecessary. All people do this. People we encounter are just being human. But does knowing all this stop me from judging? Of course not. All that judging is unconscious and automatic. To stop it, I have to take my consciousness by the collar, gently. I need to be good to myself too. And remember that not everything is about me. As a matter of fact, very little, if anything, is about me. Let me say that again. Very little, if anything, is about me. We humans move through the world with our self-centered perspective, often hardly noticing what is outside ourselves. I also have to remember that everyone's experiences are different. If I had the same experiences as the person I am judging, I would most likely act the same way. That is a really difficult concept. We like to think of ourselves as fine, civilized people, but everyone knows what happens when we are tired, hungry, or frustrated. Then we have a very hard time hanging on to our manners. One more thought about judging. If you are grateful for what you have been given in your life and think about the role luck, such as choosing the right people to be your parents, has had in your successes, this will make you less judgmental. So I ask all of you, can you catch yourself judging? Can you stop? I've tried and have very little success. This week, I will set my intention to watch my thoughts for judgments and see if I can change my judgments to observations. It may help me feel calmer. We will see.
Hi. Here I am. Many of you here at this fellowship heard me when I gave a talk about the things that have happened to me in my life. For example, having a severe learning disability, I was unable to make a living and needed to get my daughter back and get an education. So I became a sex worker. The only way that I could keep my heart intact and open was to do it with respect, compassion, and kindness for myself and my clients, seeing the sacred, seeing their humanity and the sacred in us both. I am here to talk about kindness and not judging. When I was asked to talk about these topics, even though it's so difficult for me to organize my thoughts in an understandable way, I got so excited because these topics mean so much to me personally. They are so connected and affect us all. There's a lesson that my mother taught me that I carry with me. Treat others not as they treat you, but as you would have them treat you. The golden rule. I feel to be unkind to you is equal to being unkind to me, because I see that that which is sacred within me is in you. I believe that you and I are precious, as all life is, to be honored with kindness, because we all feel. Our feelings get hurt and we become alienated. To be kind breeds more kindness, but because I'm human, I make mistakes. The withholding of judgment is an act of kindness. I see judging others as causing alienation. I try to avoid this because alienating others hurts me, because being alienated hurts me. I imagine that everyone here wishes and makes the effort to be kind and not judge. However, we are human. As humans, sometimes our minds judge without even being aware of it. There have been times when I revealed to someone that I had been a sex worker, and they have gone cold or avoided me, possibly judging me or attributing shame to it. I felt powerless to explain anything because they wouldn't ask me questions to clear up misconceptions. I felt hurt from being alienated, missing out. It makes me think of the connections I might have made if they had just felt safe asking me a question. Because they didn't, they missed out on learning something and went on their way with misconceptions. How can we judge another when none of us have any idea what another person has been through or is going through, or why they've done what they've done or not done? But where do we draw the line? Maybe at justice? And what is justice? People make assumptions about others with imperfect understanding of what is really happening. People tell themselves stories about why somebody does what they do. When we do this, we're usually wrong. It not only hurts us, others, but also hurts us, and we don't even notice this hurt. It raises barriers and closes doors to beautiful places within ourselves and relationships. It blocks us from seeing clearly and affects how we see ourselves. The seventh principle, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part, is one that I embrace wholeheartedly without limitation. If I respect the interdependent web of all existence of which I am a part, I don't want to judge another because they are part of that web. Even though we have individual bodies and experiences, and that creates the illusion that we are separate, we are interconnected, interdependent. We are one. I liken it to one infinite living organism. With all of our differences, ultimately there is no difference between us. Compassion for oneself and others helps us to be kind and not judge. Those who are unkind or judge others are also unkind and judge themselves. If we can learn to have compassion for ourselves and be kind, refraining from judgment, refraining from judging others, it is easier to have compassion and be kind and refrain. No, excuse me. If we can have compassion and be kind for ourselves, it is easier to have compassion and be kind and refrain from judging others, which also reinforces our compassion for ourselves. I think compassionate inquiry is key to not judging others or ourselves in order to understand truth. One way to refrain from judgment is to ask oneself, why do I think this about this person? Do I know this is true? Have I been in their shoes? For example, with my husband, I realized that in an argument, I have to practice being aware that there is probably a misunderstanding between us, and to have an attitude of compassionate inquiry to understand him rather than arguing, not just because I think I am right, but also thinking I know why he did something or said something and what that means about that side of him. By compassionate inquiry, we learn truth and may reach common ground. I personally appreciate it when someone comes to me and asks me a personal question about something that they may be a little confused about, even if it is a controversial question, because it clears up misunderstandings that block opportunities for relationships. It's a remedy to misunderstanding, misjudgment, and alienation. Through compassionate inquiry, we are practicing kindness and are helping both ourselves and others in our present and future, setting up a trajectory of positive future interactions. It influences others and sends helpful waves outward in ways that we aren't even aware. It's loving kindness. Since I've shared my story with the fellowship, I've experienced such a profound healing of a very deep wound, a sense of alienation by society that I felt most of my life. I now feel connected to society and humanity at a personal level with a sense of inclusion and acceptance that I've never known before, all because of the way this congregation received my talk, beginning with all the encouragement to do the talk and ending with the way people responded to me and the talk. All this because of the kindness and lack of judgment by so many people of this congregation. This demonstrates how non-judgment and kindness heals. It heals. Thank you.
A man buys a falafel sandwich from a Buddhist monk street vendor. He gives the vendor $10 and asks for change. And the vendor tells him that change comes from within. Lawrence Shapiro, PhD, our family therapist of the last 30 years, knows all of my family's stories, and most of which are incredibly boring. Dr. Shapiro is a consistent source of wisdom and good advice. And during one of our visits, I mentioned to him a friend who was living an absolute nightmare. She had serious illness and horrible financial and relationship problems. I told him that I did not know how she could bear up under all this strain. And he said something I've never forgotten. He said, if you really knew how many burdens people are carrying, you would be surprised that they could walk upright. And this is true. We never know what loads a person carries, even if we think we know the person well. And this can apply to family members as well as it does to friends, coworkers, and strangers on the street. This is a real life example. I was in my 40s when I learned why my father, who was a workaholic and could often be cold and distant, had little if any contact with his birth family, and was seldom expressing affection to me or my siblings. During an extremely rare visit from one of his sisters, we learned that at the age of 8, my father and all of his siblings, older and younger, had seen their mother die from a gunshot wound inflicted by their father. His mother was buried on his 9th birthday. And his father, my grandfather, was acquitted of all charges and raised his children alone. It was during the Great Depression, and the county did not want to take on the responsibilities of and the costs of raising 7 motherless children. Now, this revelation did not change our father into a warm and cuddly individual unless it involved a cat. He loved cats. But it certainly changed our perceptions of him and his behavior. And we have a tendency to judge people based on what we see and how they treat us and what we think we know about them, and all too often our judgments are totally wrong. And this is where loving kindness enters the picture. Getting into the habit of treating others, especially difficult people, and you know who you are, with tenderness, kindness, consideration, and compassion, may not change the person's behaviors or attitudes, but it may change how we interact and respond to them. And quite possibly the changes that come from within us may affect changes that we may never see. And here's a disclaimer. I wish I could say that I practice loving kindness 100% of the time, but no. When I was just a child, aged 51, I became an English as a second language teacher. And starting to teach that late in life allowed me to use some of the lessons I had learned in my life on the job, such as recognizing and nipping bullying in the bud, and recognizing when something was not quite right with a student. And two kids come to mind, and these are not their real names. Jorge, a recent arrival from El Salvador, who was an inattentive and extremely distractible ninth grader. And Camille, a fourth grader from South Asia who did not tie his shoes. Now, Jorge presented no problems in class, and this was a problem. Weeks turned into months, and he began to learn English, albeit slowly, but he seldom spoke in either Spanish or English, and he seldom, if ever, joked around with his fellow Spanish-speaking students. And one expects a ninth grade boy to do just that. He was so quiet in class that at times he seemed to just disappear. His mother was a single parent who worked multiple jobs and was finally able to come to school to speak with me and his other teachers. And what she had to say via our interpreters explained a lot. As a small child, Jorge had been diagnosed with petit mal seizures. And these seizures, which are also known as absence seizures, show staring off into space, stopping speech in the middle of a sentence, or appearing suddenly motionless. And these were exactly what other teachers and I had noticed in class. Now, Camille. Camille, fourth grader, cooperative, 10-year-old, who did not appear to present many problems in class or to have any problems with his homework. He got along well with his classmates, although at times he displayed behaviors one would expect from a far younger child. Now, he was never rude. He was never disrespectful. He was just very young for his age. He had frequent unexplained absences, and he did not tie his shoes. If his shoes came untied, he presented his foot to a teacher or another kid in class, and they would take care of it. Well, his absences occasioned the need for a parent-teacher conference. So the father arrives at the school accompanied by Camille and a couple of his sisters. Now Camille's sisters hovered around him and played with him while we were speaking with his father. They made sure that he had a comfortable place to sit, and if there was something to drink, he was offered it. And seeing these interactions provided us with our aha moment. Camille, it turns out, was the honored only son in a family of daughters. If he did not want to go to school, he didn't go. He didn't tie his shoes because he didn't have to. His sisters took care of shoe tying, and I strongly suspect his homework. Now, these stories are many years old. As I said, I was a mere child at the time, And I do not know what happened to Jorge or Camille. I don't know if Jorge completed his education, and I don't know if Camille ever tied his shoes. But I don't think that knowing the stories behind my father, Jorge, and Camille affected changes in their behavior. But thinking of those stories reminds me that knowing what I do not know is very important, and that practicing loving kindness can change how I treat people, and in some small way, perhaps change the world for the better. Now, practicing loving kindness is even more important to me now in my 70s than it was years ago. At our ages, we have all known and continue to know people who are making disastrous decisions. As my friend Will says, at my age, I've seen the light at the end of the tunnel, and it is a train. So most of the time, we can do nothing besides stand aside and watch and remind ourselves that we will never know everything about people and their lives and why they do what they do. So we can work hard, and it is hard work, to extend to them tenderness, kindness, consideration, and compassion. And I hope by doing so, we can ease back on our tendencies to be judgmental and to treat them better and to possibly make the world a tiny bit better place.
Our last reflection on kindness and not judging is an excerpt from a sermon entitled A Different Church by Reverend Gail Giesenheimer, a UU minister. She expected judgment and received acceptance when she entered a UU church for the first time. I was forthrightly evangelized into Unitarian Universalism. I was 38 years old, living in Maine, driving a snowplow for a living and feeling very sorry for myself when a friend invited me to the church. He said it was different. I really refused. I cursed the church. All blanking churches are the same. I informed him. They say they're open-minded, but they don't want queer folk. To heck with church. My friend persisted. He knew the church was different. He told me the church cared about people, embraced diverse families, and worked to make a better world. He assured me I could come and not have to hide any aspects of myself, so I went. And I dressed so carefully for my first Sunday when I spiked my short hair straight up into the ear. I dug out my heaviest, oldest work boots, the ones with the chainsaw cut that exposed the steel toe. I bet that was fun. I got my torn blue jeans and my leather jacket. There would be not a shred of ambiguity on Sunday morning. They would embrace me in my full Amazon glory, or they could fry ice. I carefully arranged for my outfit so it would highlight the rock-hard chip I carved on my own shoulder. I bundled up every shred of pain and hurt and betrayal I had harbored from every other religious experience in my life, and I lumbered into that meeting house on the coast of Maine. I expected the gray-haired ladies in the foyer to step back in fear. That would have been familiar. Instead, they stepped forward, offered me a bulletin, a newsletter, and invited me to stay for coffee. It was so odd. They never even flinched. They called me dear. Stay for coffee, dear. I stayed for coffee. I stayed for the Unitarian Universalism. Over time, the good folk of that church loved up the scattered parts of me and guided me from shattered whole, from outcast to the beloved whole. And those folks listened to me. I and my life partner became their poster child for the brand new welcoming congregation program, designed to help congregations live in their values. Let's see, live in their values for effective welcoming of LGBTQ people. And then went on to provide important local pastoral and legislative ministries to gay folk in Down East Maine. We walked together and we helped each other grow. Please don't think the transition was smooth or swift. These were not imaginary superheroes, they were human beings, and this was the mid-1980s. During the worship service on my second or third Sunday, a woman stood during Joey's and Concerns to announce that all homosexuals had AIDS, all homosexuals were deviants who could not be trusted with children, public health, or civil society. All homosexuals should be quarantined, packed off to work camps to provide useful labor to society and keep their filthy lifestyle and deadly diseases to themselves. As the member spoke, I slowly sat upright from my customary slouch, tucked in my arms, looked furtively around to see who might be glaring in my direction, and tried to remember if I had parked my truck facing in or out in the parking lot. In this journey of covenant, the congregation had just stumbled over an important crossroad. But as joys and concerns continued, not one person made reference to the call to quarantine all homosexuals. The pulpit that morning was ably filled by a student from the local seminary. At the end of the sharing, the seminarian made a brief comment to assure us that all our sentiments voiced this morning represented the whole congregation. And that was that. The congregation would not get stuck in conflict, mired in name-calling, or diverted from its general, steady task towards building the beloved community. Now I was at my own crossroad. I left quickly after the service, but what about next Sunday? Would I go back? Why on earth would I go back? That would be, will you fill in the word, dangerous, stupid, foolhardy, looking for trouble, probably hurtful. But back I went. I was in the throes of learning my first lessons of being in covenant with a congregation. When we covenant to walk together through all that it brings, it means that we don't walk away. Oh, how we may want to walk away. But our covenants call us to abide and work things through. The next week, the regular minister was back. The service began as usual. I tensed up when joys and concerns came around. Someone announced something like a birthday. I don't fully remember. But I vividly remember that one by one, folks stood up and awkwardly announced that not everything said last week was right or true, a representative of who we were as Unitarian Universalists. The crossroad had been engaged. The direction the congregation would take was being chosen. This congregation would not get stuck in conflict, mired in name-calling, or diverted from its general steady track towards building the beloved community. Our aspirations were unfolding one voice at a time. That's it. Thank you.
This is the time in our service when we ask that you remember that we share our gifts here through pledging and donations. Instructions for payments to the fellowship are on a slide during the announcements before the service every week. And while you're considering your gifts to the fellowship, remember that each month, LCUUF donates 5,000 pesos or more to an organization providing food aid in our lakeside community. For the month of October, we're supporting Food Bank Lakeside. If you're attending on Zoom, please add something for Share the Basket when you pay your pledge. You can donate in the same way that you pay your pledge, but please donate Share the Basket separately, or indicate what part of your donation is for Share the Basket. The offering will now be given and received. Let us extinguish our chalices with these words, which we read together. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world. As we go out into the world and back to our everyday lives today, when we look at others, may we remember, there but for fortune go I. May we take a moment when we are angry, irritated, or frustrated with others to breathe, and then another moment to reconsider our automatic response. May our considered response be more positive and kinder toward others than the automatic response we might have made. May it be so.